Welcome to early 2000s FPS month, where, of course, I'll be reviewing first-person shooters from two decades ago, specifically two games from 2001 and one from 2002. Feeling old yet? It's good to be back doing theme month. I wanted to do one last year, but due to some scheduling issues, read laziness and depression, I just canceled and reviewed a stupid Sonic Racer. Speaking of, considering that I mostly talk about racing games, does that mean that's gonna be all rush surface level reviewing, coupled with constant complaining about how unfair it is, jokes about schwacking and fucking your mom, random soundbites for gameplay footage, and random out of context clips that may or may not have anything to do with what I'm talking about?
Why do we always have to listen to this old stuff, Sarge?
Well, aside from the soundbites stuff and the Super Slam reviewing, sometimes, not really. I'm not bugging enough for that. Ah! I don't want to come back! When you think of influential games, what comes to mind? CSM Miami for the PC? Before the turn of the 21st century, home consoles were well known for FPSs. During the 5th generation, although there have been some good ones, the controls didn't do justice, as they were stuck with the D-pad to move and the shoulder buttons to strafe. It's bearable, but with the advent of dual analog sticks starting with the PS1, Argonaut Games did something groundbreaking when making Alien Resurrection. 3 years after the film was released and nobody cared, they mapped the movement to the sticks, and admittedly it controls just as good as most shooters of today. It's just too bad that it was critically bombed because of that for some reason. Another one of those that revolutionized the console FPS was Rare's famously dated by today's standards, GoldenEye for the N64, back when people actually cared about Alien Resurrection. Coupled with a fun campaign and full-player split-screen deathmatch, it was proven to be a popular title for the system. But it wasn't enough for console and PC shooters to coexist. I'm sorry, I just don't have my nostalgia goggles with me because I didn't play it during my childhood, as I was basically playing dumb racing games, but seriously, how do you survive on that frame rate even in 1997? Doom 64 is more stable than that! While Argonaut revolutionized the controls and Rare added multiplayer at the last minute, there was one game that put console FPSs and a notorious console brand on the map. Time Splitters? Ever heard of NOP? It's spun backwards, I know. This punk clone was made by University of Chicago student Alex Seropian as a fun little project. It was then that he later founded Bungie in 1991 after his graduation. One of the notorious projects is Marathon, released in 1994, which is basically Doom for Macs. Oh yeah, before the breakthrough from Microsoft, they did stuff for Macintoshes. It was supposed to be a sequel to Something You Shouldn't Care About, it's just a footnote, but then it evolved into a futuristic shooter about aliens and rampant AI causing chaos in a colony ship. Wait, it was really successful that it became a trilogy, ending it with Marathon Infinity. And then disaster struck when Bungie bungled the uninstallation program for MIF 2, where it removes everything from the hard drive, so a big recall happened. Also, they were developing this little game called Halo. Oh shit, that! Development started in 1997 when MIF 2 was being developed, and like it, it was originally gonna be an RTS game, this time for both Windows and Mac. Then it evolved into a third-person shooter, which was gonna have an open world, then Bungie became strapped for cash on that MIF 2 mess, and then Microsoft bought them, which probably left Steve Jobs jealous and angry. Microsoft told Bungie to make their Halo project a launch title for their newfangled black box, and having less than a year to develop it on an unproven console, there were a lot of compromises. Open world was removed, missions were cut, the perspectives finally changed to first person, although vehicles still used third person, the multiplayer was rebuilt from scratch, and God, I hate crunch! But alas, Halo is finally here, right on time, on November 15th, 2001 in America. Despite critical acclaim, initial sales were rather lukewarm as it was being squashed by other launch titles like Dota 3, Project Gotham Racing, and whatever the hell this is. But then, months and months later, through word of mouth, it became a commercial success, becoming the best-selling launch title for the system. That was faster than Among Us! Well, I think I've wasted 5 minutes or something, so let's jump in. Trademark. This isn't my first rodeo with the game. I've only played the first two levels, plus a few online matches in the PC version, the one Gearbox did. Oh yeah, Gearbox ported the game to PC in 2003, which has some graphical effects removed or toned down, non-interpolated animation which looks weird running at 60, and shades AI behavior. It's a far cry from Tony Hawk 3, but despite that, it's times like these that I wish they stayed at porting. While I'll be looking at that than the original Xbox version, which you can get digitally on the 360 store, as well as its remaster apparently, I'll be mainly playing Saber Interactive's Anniversary version for the Master Chief Collection, available on the Xbox and PC. Don't worry, I won't give you a headache by playing the enhanced graphics, I'll get there. I didn't have much memory of playing Halo, and that still gives me goosebumps. This is the Xbox version of the game. The Gearbox version has this menu as well, but it doesn't have that cool loading screen. I felt robbed. While it says Halo on the title screen, the full title is Halo Combat Evolved. The reason for that subtitle is because Microsoft didn't want the public to know that it's a malicious game, since the Halo is usually thought to be a floating golden ring on the head of a cleaned up inaccurate to the Bible angel. Still better than thinking you are the wheelman is a good subtitle for driver. I mean, it is, but it feels tacked on. The game starts somewhere in space as the Pillar of Honor reaches a ring wall while also being in a conflict with a group called the Covenant.
Cortana, all I need to know is did we lose them?
I think we both know the answer to that.
Oh hey, it's Zoe! Despite their best efforts to scare from the glass planet of Reach, the Covenant are still catching up with them, leading to Captain Keyes to order his men to defend the ship, as well as ordering Cortana to release the Master Chief.
I've already begun.
Sexy girl, put her in the thumbnail. Don't lie, if that blonde straight cunt decided to re-review this game, you too would expect him to put or commission Cortana in the thumbnail to show you off her goods. Either that or put a face-tap smile on Keyes instead.
All you greenhorns who wanted to see Covenant up close, this is gonna be your lucky day.
Apparently the dialogue in this part is different depending on the difficulty.
Men, put your eyes downrange, fingers on your triggers, and we all go home in one piece. Man, here's where we show those split-chin, squid-head sons of bitches that they could not have picked a worse enemy than the human race. We are going to blow the hell out of those dumb bugs until we don't have anything left to shoot them with. And then, we are going to strangle them with their own living guts. Man, we sent those dumb bugs out to the middle of nowhere to keep from getting their filthy claws on Earth. But we stumbled onto something they're so hot for that they're scrambling over each other to get it. Well, I don't care if it's God's own anti-son-of-a-bitch machine or a giant hula hoop. We're not going to let them have it. What we will let them have is a belly full of lead and a pool of their own blood to drown in.
Anyways, that tall son of a bitch wakes up and gets into a testing regime, only to cut short when the Covenant forces invade. Can I just say that I prefer MCC's way of telling how the controls work instead of a pausing pop-up? I wish more games had that feature, seems more natural that way. As he reaches the bridge, the ship meets Keyes, giving him the bad news. But at least he gets to meet Cortana once more, only for the Covenant forces to destroy the main cannon.
It must have been one of their boarding parties. I guess an antimatter charge.
So it doesn't really matter. Keyes orders almost everyone to evacuate the ship, while he tries to land it safely on the Ringworld. And from then on, Master Chief carries Cortana inside his helmet as they make their escape through these little cramped corridors while shooting at these bastards and shield dicks. The first map isn't so bad, it's a great start for a game, but it'll get better from then on. They finally found the last escape pod in E and a few other Marines leave the scene. You know how Unreal opens with you escaping a prison ship and as you leave, you witness some beautiful scenery?
We're coming in too fast! Damn! Airbrake failure! They flew too early!
Chief? Chief, can you hear me? At last! Are you alright? Can you move?
Well, I present to you, it's Popular Evolution. And it's a great segue to the presentation part. Okay, so picture this. You're playing with the anniversary graphics. You make me sick. It's like listening to the music video version of a song. Unless it's Take On Me, why would you do that? But I'll be back to that. For a 2001 game, these graphics look really great. I have a soft spot for models in games of this era, trying to make it look as real as possible with the technology at the time. It has a bit of a cartoony look, much like Deus Ex, but at least they move and emote better. Even today, the environments look so breathtaking. It's games like these that tell that shiny graphics doesn't always make a game look better. Still not there yet. The Xbox version looked better compared to the ports, as it has better effects. The Gearbox port and an older version of the Anniversary Remaster, which is based on that, lacked that stuff, but thankfully it got reinstated for the use of mods for the former and a recent update for the latter, at least the MCC version. Regardless, it's just as good as back then. I have a bunch of questions about these graphics though. Don't get me wrong, they look fantastic, but I feel like Saber did too much that it deviates from the original aesthetic. Compare with, for instance, Spyro Reignited Trilogy. While it has its faults, it follows the aesthetic and character pretty close to the original when T4B gave it a new coat of paint. Here? Just fuck up the art direction, even if none of it makes sense. While we're at it, lighten up the dark areas. That'll improve the library level, right? Why is everything so brown in second map? I don't want to remember that pissing era of games. Why are we playing Quake instead? And as we all know, graphics can also affect gameplay. Despite the maps being bright enough that you don't need a flashlight in darker levels, they made the enemies somehow blend into the background. Plus, some mountains have different geometry yet still have the same hitboxes from the original, with the worst offender being the trees. The trunks are thick in the original, whereas with the 2011 graphics, they're thin, and yet the graphics are playing mind games with you. It's like you're shooting at an invisible force field. And even if you aren't those things out, it's really CPU bound, more so in larger areas, meaning that I came across encoding overloading more often than playing with the 2001 graphics. The footage came out smoothly still, but god, I need a Ryzen. Thankfully, you can switch graphics by pressing Tab, and you can also choose which graphics or music you want to see and hear in the music menu. Downside, it doesn't shade to HUD, and you can't switch during cutscenes. It's just so weird to see these remade cutscenes, like, what's going on with you, Cortana? Hot take, but I prefer Cortana being purple. Interestingly enough, Halo Anniversary is actually running two instances of the game at the same time, one running with the old graphics, and another with the new graphics. And despite that, I'm surprised it's running well on my PC. Sure, I've recorded the footage at 1024x576, so OBS won't get an encoding overload, but still, I prefer the old graphics though. I don't want to ramble too much about the 2011 graphics, basically I'm just reiterating what Noodle said in that Halo Anniversary video, so go watch that. I'll give them points for improving the sound in 2011 mode though. It has more beef compared to the original. Except for the Warthog, which is quieter apparently. Sticking with the original, audio is pretty great. It has the assortment of stock sound effects and reverse voice speech for the elites. I love them. Except you. Voice acting is great too, with the likes of Steve Downes, Jen Taylor, Pete Stacker, Tim Dedebo, and others throwing their best performances they can. And they do deliver. But whenever I hear Cortana, I kept thinking that it's Zoe helping me instead.
Are you kidding me? This is the middle of nowhere. We left all those people behind for this? Charger! Hunter!
That's terrific, Cupcake. Look, is there a man up there that maybe we can talk to?
Woohoo! I don't know what to do! Go to hell, Colonel Sanders!
Hey, lighten up! Man, nobody can take a joke anymore.
I need to play more Mario.
Man, I love Steam.
So the graphics, the audio, and the voice acting are quite iconic, but you know what's missing? The music. It is an amazing listen, having a wide variety of styles composed by Martin O'Donnell and Michael Salvatore. How did they go from this?
Flintstones, America's favorite.
To this is beyond me, but they managed to pull it off in spades.
Thank you.
The presentation isn't everything if the gameplay is shit, but it's really great. At least better than Half-Life, despite having half map for grenades by default in MWC. But sticking with the gamepad, it's more like modern shooters. Stick for walking and looking, and right trigger for shooting. Now here's the weird stuff. To zoom in on your weapon, you don't use the left trigger. What do you think this is? Call of Duty? That's for throwing grenades! You click the right stick for that. Speaking of pineapples, the game has two grenade types and you change by pressing black button. Real talk, what's with the Xbox controller? I'm talking both of them. Why are start and select on the left side and the color buttons on the right side? Why aren't these two the short buttons at the beginning? The face buttons are fine though. Use it as a melee weapon with the B button, a trendsetter. Jump by pressing A, X for reloading, and Y for changing weapons. It seems like this game also started a few more trends for modern shooters. First is the two-weapon system, where you've guessed it, can only carry two weapons at a time. It gives you a bit of a challenge where you can either keep a weapon or replace it with a different one. At least it's not Duke Nukem Forever, so this gets a pass.
Power armor is for pussies.
Then there's health regeneration, or rather, shield regeneration. Unlike in the sequels, your health and shield are separate here. When the shield goes down, you're more vulnerable to enemy gunfire, so you must take cover for the suit to safely recharge it. I really love this. This makes a lot more sense as this is a sci-fi game where you control a super soldier in a suit of green armor with a shield. Not a soldier during the Iraqi war. It still plays like Mortal Kombat, except you take damage and you must patch up in case of a plasma explosion. As you reach the first outpost, you've been confronted by one of many countless as dropships keep coming down till the game tells you it's over. At the beginning, you fight against the Ungoys, the Sangailis, and the Kagyars. Grunts, elites, and jackals as we commonly call them respectively. Grunts are the short ones who can speak English.
More here!
Either it's one of those species that came up with the language first and don't call it English, or the translator and the master chief can only describe them and not the rest. It's the latter. Anyways, they're cowards that shoot you and throw devastating plasma grenades with zap your shield and some health. Which should give me an indicator because I constantly get caught off guard by these. You have the elites with many variants, shielded ones, camoed ones, and energy sword sundae. I hate them. These golden ones can wield these one-hit swords and I hate them. The rest are okay. The shielded ones in particular take a while to put them down compared to the camo ones, so it's best to use your pistol and or their plasma rifle, easily two of the best in the game. I kept hoping if they can drop that when they die. Then you have those jackal bastards. Their shears are different as they're more like those medieval ones. Be warned as those with plasma pistols can charge their shots but can destroy your shield. Hate that too. Still, even if you have to do a skill shot, you're as cowardly as the grunts. After killing a lot of covenant boys, a pelican comes in as you see more light bulbs coming down to the ring. This is the part where it introduces the all-iconic waterfall when it halos handful of usable vehicles. Nah, too obvious of a reference.
This cave is not a natural formation.
Yeah, no shit! Controlling the Warhog is an interesting affair. I've played many races in my life, after all, I'm the racer girl. Usually when using a controller, you use two of the face buttons or the triggers to accelerate and brake, and the left stick or D-pad to steer. And this is still the norm to this day, ever since, well, when consoles existed. They are driving slash racing games that use an orthodoxically different control schemes, but they're few and far between. Unfortunately, Halo is one of them. Much like an RC car, use the left stick to accelerate and brake, and the right stick to steer. And by that, I mean steering to where the camera is pointing at. Yeah, it's really weird even today, and I'm still not used to it as I kept moving the left stick left and right like a standard driving game. Since I had to fight through waves of Covenant fools before the survivors are rescued, let's talk about the weapons. First up is the pistol, without a doubt the most OP gun in the game. You can kill an elite quicker with a few headshots, even from far enough with an invisible scope. This gun is so useful that most online gamers use it in Slayer matches. It's a lot more useful than the assault rifle. This is a worse. Sure, the design is iconic and you can get a lot of reserve ammo, but it's just so weak and you can run out of it before you reload. It takes a lot of balls to kill an elite. No wonder we're losing the war. The Covenant have better weapons than this. Speaking of which, their plasma guns are a godsend. Like the pistol, they kill Covenants quicker, but with the plasma pistol, it can let you do a charged homing shot and no need for reloading. Downside is that for both, you have to keep picking up their weapons when you run out of ammo, and the plasma rifle takes longer to cool down, but under that, great weapons overall. Can't say about the needler though, they shoot almost homing needles that stick with you and damage you as they break. I don't use them much. There's also specialty weapons like the rocket launcher and sniper rifle, which are self-explanatory, and the shotgun. Yes! 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 This is a good shotgun, holding 12 shells before reloading, and a fast one as well. Shit, is that it for weapons? That sucks. At least there's two types of grenades, a human one which doesn't take long to explode, and a covenant one which, despite its long cooking time, is sticks to enemies and has a devastating explosive attack. And they're volatile too, so be careful when you see pickable ones during skirmishes. Well, some bad news, the captain got captured, so you head where the ship called Trooper Reconciliation is being docked to save him. Wait, that's named after the South African Commission after apartheid ended, isn't it? Are we the baddies? It's part sniping mission, part the gulag, except we already know who the prisoner is. This is where you meet the Magaligolos. Hunters to be more anglicized. They're heavily armored and use their so-called Furon guns, same weapons used for the Banshees, which are as bad as plasma grenades, but the best approach to kill them is to shoot their backs, so do their approach them so that they can charge at you. Well, how about a trip through identical hallways to find keys? It's still good and all, but this isn't the only one with that kind of level design. You've already witnessed the first level after all. No, this is the last time you'll be in this ship. So he found keys, and he spits exposition about the covenant claiming this halo thing, and trying to use it as a weapon. Hope this won't get retconned. Glad this is the only escort mission in the game as he waltz back to the hangar to steal a dropship. No! Here it is, folks, the Silent Cartographer, a level so famous Wikipedia has a page about it. This is where you go around the island in search of a map to see where the control room is. The level is as unique as the second level, big wide open spaces, enough to drive around with the Warhawk, while also balancing with some spectacular indoor sections. Sure, you have to do a bit of backtracking after activating the doors to the map room, but it's not enough to piss me off.
Don't let them lock the doors!
And then there's attack on the control room. After finding out what it is, the ship goes underground with full hammer, head to the different snowy side of the halo, and head from there. Up until this level, the game offered many battles where you must kill waves after waves of enemies before you progress. Well, you're not gonna witness those for a while, thankfully. This level introduces a lot of stuff, such as more durable vehicles, like the Scorpion. Which I'm guessing it's made out of cardboard! It's probably the anniversary port, but the tank doesn't protect me from shit! Thankfully, there's also the Ghost, a Covenant vehicle with its own health bar that can strafe and shoot. Now that is my style! It also has Covenant's own tanks, the Wraiths, which shoot like trebuchets. Yeah, don't fuck with the plasma rocks, folks. Man, this level goes on for a long while, but that is not the biggest problem. It's time to talk about the map's lowest points, the indoor sections. Ironic for me to say, as I don't like wide open areas in FPS games, but with the exception of Halo and the Silent Cartographer, the maps tend to have identical indoor rooms that you must traverse. You had a taste of it in Truth and Reconciliation, so now you must witness its full potential. This isn't the worst offender though, I'll get there.
You all right?
Never been better. You can't imagine the wealth of information. The knowledge, so much, so fast. It's glorious.
So, what sort of weapon is it?
This ring isn't a cudgel, you barbarian. It's something else.
She finds something terrible hiding in the LON.
Captain, we've got to stop the captain.
Keys?
Weapons cache he's looking for. It's not really... We can't let him get inside.
Well, that was a surprise! So we have to stop Keys from using the halo or something. I didn't understand either. How's those last 5 maps? Pretty fun, eh? Well, Starbird sells in for the ultimate surprise, much more than Hogan doing the leg job on Randy Savage at the Bash of the Beach 96. And much like that pay-per-view, half of it isn't much. No elites, only grunts and jackals, but the scenery is so dark and mysterious, giving you clues of what's to come. And as you reach that tunnel, everything goes to shit. You go down, kill some more Covenant fools, and why is he holding the wrong weapon? You see a video file of Keys and Johnson's man's cut in this very structure, and
what is that?
Where's that coming from, everywhere. Mendoza?
I don't...
There! Mira!
Hold still! Hold still! Let him have it!
It keeps me sane. Introducing the Flood, infecting aliens that consume living things and make them as their servants. It suddenly turns this game from a fun romp about killing aliens too.
They wield weapons too?
Not only that, but they also sometimes act as zombies in blood, so it's annoying but also frightening to see them back up, and you have to make sure they stay dead. Hitting them when they're down won't work, so you must wait. Hey fellas, maybe we should make a truce so that we can kill those floods. Well, fuck you, Van! This level has the same problem as the last one, identical rooms and all, but the reveal is so effective that I largely don't care. Thank god I got out of that hellhole and got reconnected with my marines. It's just a shame that the new flood order is spreading. After making your way to this place, you're suddenly teleported to meet 343 Guilty Spark, the guiltiest of Sparks, as they tell to get the index, aka the keys to activate Halo, from the library, so they both teleport there. Oh boy, here we go. Sure, the place is infested with flood zombies, carries, and all that jazz, but it's not the worst part. What it actually is that— SON OF A BITCH! THEY USE ROCKETS TOO?! I hate the flood. Anyway, that's not the case here. The worst part is that it's so drab and repetitive. It's so muted and brown, and the rooms and hallways look the same. It takes the repeating parts of AOCR up to 11, and because of that, it feels like it's taking forever, not to mention having 4 sections divided by elevator rides. It's all shrinking through the halls, killing zombies and carriers, waiting for Spark to unlock doors. It's a slog, to be honest. And Spark dropping a lot of exposition isn't fucking helping.
The installation was specifically built to study and contain the flood. Their survival
Shut up! Let us never go through that bullshit again. So Sparky and Shiv get the index and are sent to the control room to activate Halo's defenses. Cortana isn't happy though.
I've spent the last 12 hours cooped up in here watching you toady about helping that thing get set to slit our throats.
Hold on now. He's a friend.
Oh, I didn't realize. He's your pal, is he? Your chum? Do you have any idea what that bastard almost made you do?
She's cute when she's angry. Why did I say that? It turns out that Halo doesn't kill the Flood, it actually kills everyone else, and I mean everyone else in the galaxy, so that the Flood die of starvation. My god, that's like the inverse of the Holocaust, but worse! That was Blake, sorry. But Sparky is technically correct about it, the best kind of correct. Alas, he betrays you, and so you have to fight Sanders along your way now. Weird to see you spawn with the weapons carried over from the last level. Normally you'd start with the level with a pistol and an assault rifle, either that or a sniper rifle in TNC. Hey, remember the 5th level with the repeating rooms and hallways in between outside areas? They're back, with a vengeance. You basically have to do the level almost backwards, now without the floodies and sentinels. This time, you have to use banshees to get up to the generators to overload the shields. In fact, the last 3 levels are basically just backtracking your way to the objective with some new stuff sprinkled in. And I wouldn't mind much at this point. With that said, I cannot despise it more than AOCR, but at least you can get to pilot banshees. From then on, the Flood have become the main enemy. That doesn't mean the Covenant don't set a chance against them. Case in point, oh god, this final part before the last general was an embarrassment. I've tried so hard killing everyone so that I can snatch a banshee up there only to get killed. Again, again, and again, and again, enough to make me rage and cry. I spent like 30 minutes? An hour? I lost count because I was so fucking livid at this part. Stupid of me that I passed the checkmark before I actually stacked up on ammo, so I had to go back to that replenishment place so that I can mow down those cunts, only to die and have to get through the process again. Then I used the ghost and cleared the area. What?! Thought I couldn't get past through that cliff with the ghost. It's still a hard sort of a bitch trying to avoid the wraith's attacks, but it's a whole lot easier than on foot. Oh! 2 wraiths? Really? For 1 Spartan? I really miss my marines. Thankfully, the last 2 levels are easier, and hey, Cortana can teleport him to the truth ship. How convenient. There's keys where you get the captain to activate the pillar's destruction. Too late for that. He's nothing more than a key shed at this point. Thank you, I'll be here all week. Man, this part just keeps spawning floodies, enough to just ignore it and move on. And now there's grunts that wield the same guns as the hunters, woo! And then there's the last one, the Maw. The Sentinels are back, yay! As you reach the bridge, Cortana activates a self-destruct sequence, but look who decided to show up.
Ridiculous! That you would imbue a warship's AI with such a wealth of knowledge? Weren't you worried it might be captured or destroyed?
Sparky stops and it gathers human information, so you must restart the thingy by shoving grenades up the exhausts. Yeah, that's how nuclear reactors work. These floods never stop showing up! After that, you head to the elevator and escape to where Fullhammer is gonna get ya. You may think it's gonna be hard, but no. It's actually quite easy, even if you're still not used to his controls. So the game is over, right?
Cortana to Echo 419. Two Covenant Banshees are approaching on your six. Evade. Say again, evade.
Well,
ship's inventory shows one longsword fighter is still docked in Launch Bay 7. If we move now, we can make it.
Oh, how convenient. Not even these obstacles can stop me! Oh. One minute to spare. I can kill a few idiots on the way. There we go. It wasn't that difficult of an escape.
Did anyone else make it?
Scanning. Just dust and echoes.
Then how the hell is Sergeant Johnson still alive? Well, that's over with. Great game, had difficult sections that made me mad, but overall, it was good fun. Fuck the Flood. Single player is well remembered, but multiplayer on the other hand is more remembered fondly. In the original Xbox version, you can only play split screen or system link. This was before the days of Xbox Live. However, the Gearbox PC port has online multiplayer covered with some exclusive MP maps like Death Island, based on the Silent Cartographer. I can't review it properly because it was laggy as heck on my end, though custom edition is working fine for me. While the 360 version Anniversary is based on Reach, the MCC version is based on the original Xbox version. Plus extra weapons from the Gearbox port. For a long time, it has matchmaking instead of a dedicated server browser like it's 2009 again. Thankfully, recent updates added that for custom games. You can either play co-op or competitive multiplayer with tons of game modes like Slayer, which is another word for deathmatch, Capture the Flag, King of the Hill, and more. It's your standard multiplayer shooting action. It's dated as it doesn't have the features fans know about, at least not according to the MWC version, but it's still fun. Oh great, my internet connection went down. Guess I'll have to wait to get to another... This is a common issue since the collection was released. The multiplayer in MCC has its fair share of problems, like matchmaking takes its sweet time to search for players. It can take longer than an average Slayer game here. But this? It doesn't matter if you intentionally quit or the internet went down during your match because it doesn't know the difference. You'll get banned either way. My internet isn't the best. It tends to drop at random times, so that is a problem for me because if it drops during a session, I get banned. And the ban times will increase after repeating disconnections. At least I still have Custom Edition. But other than that, it's all great fun. As this is the Master Chief Collection, you receive bonuses for killing and assists, which applies to other games. You get to level up, complete weekly challenges, and buy skins within your season points. I don't really care much. I'll wait till I get Halo 2 and 3. Well, I guess nobody likes Capture the Flag anymore. So that was Halo Combat Evolved, and yeah, it's a really great experience. Sure, it's frustrating and also repetitive at times, but it has its memorable moments. It strikes a great balance of seriousness and comedy, and the shooting action is quite entertaining and intuitive, even if the assault rifle is weak as fuck. Even with its problems, the multiplayer is quite good fun, and it paved the way for LAN parties with consoles. It is an important milestone for Microsoft, the Xbox, and Bungie. Which makes you wonder why it didn't surpass the PS2 in sales. Oh yeah, cheap DVD player this ain't. Like Master Chief said at the end of the game,
I think we're just getting started.
And from then on, the series became a juggernaut with the release of Halo 2 in 2004 with expanded lore and Xbox Live multiplayer added to the mix, and Halo 3, shattering records left and right while finishing the fight. And then Bungie broke up with Microsoft, but they did a prequel and an interquel before being snagged by cunts. So Microsoft created 343 Industries.
I am a genius.
So that they can make sequels for the sake of continuing. Screw Cortana being rampant, I'm here for the multiplayer. Not only that, but it's also a franchise with TV shows, an anime anthology, comics, and books. Lots of them. So even when some questionable stuff interjected, it seems that Halo is never gonna go away from the public's consciousness. One down, two to go. I like this special already. No interruptions, no skits, no need to borrow some voice actors to record lines. This is gonna be a breeze! Right?